How many of you have heard me speak before? So you guys heard about long-term active development, which is what I really and truly believe in. I'm going to go a little bit deeper tonight. And I'm always worried when I start because I have 142 slides, guys. I have lots of material, okay? So I'm always worried that I won't have time to go through everything, but I'm going to find a way. I'm telling you I'm going to find a way, okay? At any point, if you want to stop me for questions, please do so. You don't have to wait at the end to ask your questions. And I'm going to bring it to another level. My title of my presentation is Adapt or Die. So we're going to talk about the generation of athletes that you guys are dealing with right now, okay? That is totally different than the previous one and the one before as well, okay? So it's so important for you guys as coaches to adapt to the reality of the athletes that you're working with right now. Just a little bit more about myself. I was born and raised in Quebec City in Canada, so that's why I have this lovely French accent that you're going to be stuck with tonight. Pour mes amis francophones, si vous avez des questions en français, ça va me faire plaisir de répondre vos questions en français à n'importe quel moment. So you're going to be stuck with my accent. There's nothing I can do about it, okay? I went to school at Laval University in Quebec City, studied in human kinetics, but mainly learned lots from the Cubans. So I went to school, university in Cuba. They opened their door to me. I was really blessed to work with their national teams for quite some time. And they taught me a lot about their system. And I stole them lots of ideas, okay, that I'm going to share with you as well throughout the course of this presentation. I grew up as a kid in Quebec City, dreaming about the Montreal Expos. We had a team in Montreal at that time that we don't have anymore here in Washington. That's too bad. But my dad used to bring me to the stadium in Montreal. It was a two-hour drive, and that's how I became so passionate about this game. So that's little Andre there with Dick Williams and Andre Dawson, Hall of Famer, obviously, that you probably recognize already. Then I became employed by Baseball Canada. And the funny thing is that in 2004, they asked me, after being a coach with boys so many years, they said, Andre, we are starting a women's baseball team in Canada, and we would like you to be the head coach of that team. I said, are you kidding me? He said, that's not happening. I'm not coaching women in baseball. Like, what are we talking about? And they said, you know, like, why don't you try it and see what happens? If you like it, then you keep going. If you don't like it, then we'll put someone else. I gave it a try, and after 13 years, I'm still coaching women's. I will not go back at teaching and coaching boys in baseball never again. Okay, I'm having a blast. The photo there is with the young group that we bring in Cuba every year to get them into the national team program. We've had successes also at the Pan Am Games, World Championship along the way as well. Really proud of that group of athletes that I've been working with for so many years. Like I like to brag sometimes. Sorry, American friends, but we've passed them. It's awesome, okay? And we're now second best team in the world, and we're really proud of that, being in Nordic countries with tons of snow, being able to claim that we are ahead of the Americans. It's lovely, okay? So like I said, buckle up. I have tons of information. And I'm going to start just with a little refresh on long-term athlete development, just so we make sure we're on the same page. And then I'm going to dig deeper, because what I showed you last time was version 1.0. We are at now version 3.0. Things has evolved over the years. I have lots of videos too, so no, this is not when you see that, guys, what do you see? What comes to mind when you see that? And those of you who were there last night with me in French, not allowed to say a word. So what do you see when you see the cow? Tell me, anything.
Milk.
Milk. Good.
Meat.
Good. What else?
Black and white.
Black and white. Good.
Countryside.
Countryside. Perfect.
Big.
Huh?
Big cow. It's a big cow.
It's a big cow. Perfect. What else? Anything else?
Horns.
Corn. Perfect.
Corn.
Horns. Okay. What else? What else comes to mind when you see a cow? So I'll see different answers, right? So depending on your perception of what you see there, you have a different answer. So you mentioned food, right? So a big steak, because that's what comes to mind. You could see that guy working with the cows as well. You could see that, because you like cars, and you like your leather seats, and that comes from the cow, you could see that as well. You're all wondering where I'm going with this, right? So just wait. What else? Milk. You guys said milk. Maybe it's the mad cow disease that comes to mind. Maybe you like the structure of the animal, and then you're passionate about it, and then you think about that. Maybe you talk about that as well. Okay, all the shit that's going on there that serves for growing other things. Maybe you're a kid, and the only thing you know about cows is what? It's moo. That's all you know about it, right? Or you could be a butcher, and then what you want is that all the pieces of the food there. Or you could be that guy. And you know what this guy's thinking about, right? When he thinks about the cow, okay? So we all have a different perception. So basically, an athlete is like a cow. You have to keep that in mind, that whoever is surrounding the athlete, we all have a different perception and perspective on that athlete, depending on our role. Whether you're a head coach, you're a nutritionist, you're a manager, you're a sports psychologist, mental preparator, whatever it is, we all have a different perspective on the athlete. But the most important thing is for your group of people that are around the athlete is to make sure that all decisions you're making is for the benefits of the athlete that is always at the center of everything that you do. Okay? And we lose perspective of that along the way. So that's so important to get back at it. All right, so this is our long-term athlete development model that we created like now 10 years ago, that has now been adapted by lots of countries, whether it's the Middle East, in Europe, in England, Ireland, South Africa, now the United States with their ADM that is a copy-paste of what we've done. It has worked for us. Like I said, with our results that we've had at the international level, I don't know if you knew, but we're Pan Am champions with the boys, the men's team. Not only once, but the last two Pan Am games. We have more, you guys know that we have more Canadians in the major leagues than there's Japanese players? People don't know that. There's lots of names that I could tell you right now, they would say, oh, that's a Canadian. Joey Votto, Russell Martin, Paxton with the Mariners. We have more players in the major leagues than Japan. Okay? So there's something that we're doing that I think it's worth discussing. So we have three important blocks with our athlete development model. And the first one that I want to focus on is the physical literacy piece. This is your foundation. And I'm going to show you why it is the foundation of everything that we're doing. That's the new model that we just created. So we created a model with three. Actually, you're the first one to see it because it's going to be presented to our members next week. But the start, stay, succeed is something new that we just created. So we start in the system. We want to retain as many players as possible. And you know what? The succeed part is only a small portion of what we're all about. We're about having our kid stick with our game. Okay? Not about high performance anymore. We know we're going to get them. We're going to get some of those athletes at that level, but it's going to be a fraction of a percent. So we're focusing on the 99.9% of the athletes that we're dealing with. Okay? So that's really important. One of our flagship programs is the Rally Cap program. And we got rid of T-ball years ago, okay? But I wanted to prove something this summer. We did a little house survey experiment that I'm going to show you here. So what we did...
The most fascinating thing, kids have fun.
So what we did is that... this guy is not really important. Practice. So what we did is that we compared the Rally Cap program to the T-ball program, okay? And we got some measures about all kinds of different things. Okay, so I should show you, let you watch. So went to a field, brought a bunch of kids, and we exposed them to a T-ball for 45 minutes and rally cap for another 45 minutes.
Okay. With today's session, we're going to make the comparison between Baseball Canada Rally Cap program and the old-fashioned T-ball program that we used to have years ago. So we're here at the Riverside Park in LaSalle, Quebec. We're going to have a bunch of kids coming in order to participate in the Rally Cap program and in T-ball.
So if you don't remember, Rally Cap is about
the whole thing
with martial arts color belts, but we have color hats.
Understand the fundamentals of the game. They get the opportunity to not only learn how to throw, but they also get the opportunity to learn how to hit too. And it really just solidifies their knowledge of the different aspects of the game that are the building blocks that they'll need later.
Qu'est-ce que t'aimes le plus quand tu vas à l'école?
Les ateliers.
Les ateliers? Et pourquoi t'aimes les ateliers?
Parce que ça m'aide à aider mon équipe.
When the kids get to do the workshops, they obviously get to touch the ball much more often, and they get to do a lot more repetition, a lot more reps, whether it's swinging or with batting as well.
From your guys, they have improved a lot, and also, you know, I noticed that they get to Pee Wee and Bantam, they just enjoy the game, they know more about the ball game and how to use their techniques to play the ball game. We talk about the Rocket Cap program. And they have improved a lot, and also, you know, I noticed that they get to Pee Wee and Bantam, they just enjoy the game, they know more about the ball game and how to use their techniques to play the ball game.
Our kids will learn, the coaching staff will learn how to teach, how to take care of a kid. Let's go through the basic fundamentals, but doing it simply. The kids will learn, but not like at school, it will be knocked down in their heads. It'll be easy. Let's have fun.
The rally cap was a lot more dynamic. The kids were moving a lot more. They seemed not to lose interest versus the t-ball. When they play t-ball, you see a lot of kids, they were not watching. They were playing in the sand, the grass.
When the kids get to play the game, everybody's excited to hit. However, sometimes the kids that are out in the field, they may be distracted a little bit by having to wait as long in order for the ball to come to them. So the Rally Cap program really does a fantastic job in making sure that the children get to be as hands-on as much as possible.
Content a number of steps
also
improved
in session. Not be scared to create new exercises and also to make the kids come to the park and have fun to make new exercises. And so the next time they come, they know that it's going to be fun.
So that has been a success for us. So that's totally changed the landscape of how we introduce the game for the first time to our kids in Canada. Before, when we did T-ball before, the first experience was so bad, and they were quitting after 1 year, first experience, and then changed sports. Now we're keeping our sports to the point now where we don't have enough baseball fields in our country to serve all the new registration that has been increasing over the last 5 years from 10 to 20%, which is pretty important as well. So we gotta remember that kids are not adults in miniatures, okay? That's a big difference. So we don't teach kids the way we teach adults. Those are totally different type of people. And most of the time we see coaches approaching a kid the way they would approach a teenager or an adult. It's totally different things. And also we gotta remember that girls are not like boys. Right? So, in some, how many of you guys are dealing with girls in your program? So you have some playing, right? But there are two different type of people also. But sometimes we just teach them the same way, but they're different, right? And I've shown you that before. This is our framework about long-term athlete development, where it's all about your growth spurt. And we all have a growth spurt at some point. And I like to say that our best coaches should be working with athletes between the age of 12 and 17. Because this is where you make or break an athlete. This is where it's happening. But unfortunately, in my country, probably in yours also, we keep having our best coaches working with our best athletes. And that's a big problem. Because our best coaches should be working with that age group here, that is here to here. This is where the growth spurt is happening, and that's the spike that you're seeing here. Okay? And I don't want to go in detail because I don't want to repeat myself, but that growth spurt will determine if it's important to work on speed, endurance, flexibility, or strength development as well. Okay, and last time we talked about it also, is all based on measurement. Just to make sure you guys remember, what grows first in your body? Limbs, okay? Arms, legs, that grows first, okay? So you guys got to measure. You need to measure. Because when growth spurt is starting, the limbs are starting to grow. What's happening? What's growing at the same time? Ligaments are stretched like crazy. And you guys want to win so much that game on Friday night and overuse your pitchers, you don't see results right away, but injuries will start to happen when you get to 17, 18, and 19 because of decisions made by coaches just for the benefit of winning that game on Friday night. Because that kid was taller, stronger, could throw the ball and pitch the ball quicker than others. Okay? And then what grows last? Your trunk. Okay, so you gotta measure also sitting height. So you know that when your trunk is start to grow, your decel is accelerating, then you can start working on strength development. Okay? So that's very important. That's the basic of everything that we're doing with long-term athletic development, and that's supported by science. Another little quiz that I wanna make sure you guys remember. You have I just want to know if you remember. What's the best age to train speed for boys? You guys have to know that. What's the age range to train speed for boys? First one, seven to nine. There's a window of opportunity at 7 to 9 where boys will respond better to the speed development. There's another one after. That's why I want to hide it. So the first one here, 7 to 9, everything with girls happened before. Okay? That's why girls at high school are more towards boys older. Totally normal, we're done. Okay, so they want to go to girls that are older. So the second window of opportunity happens right here, during the growth spurt. If you miss this one, you don't have access to this one. So if you miss the boat between 7 and 9, forget about it, you don't have that window of opportunity between 2 to 15-ish. Okay, really important to remember that. So, we're all about that graphic, okay? The iceberg, which is really important. We want to bring our athletes to the top of the iceberg, which is fantastic, okay? The iceberg won't be over the water if there's no solid foundation underneath the water. And that solid foundation we never see. We don't see it on an athlete. We don't see it because that's everything that you've done before. And that's what we call physical literacy. All the movement fundamentals that you've trained before, that's going to make you a better athlete and eventually make you a better baseball player. So your role as coaches and responsibilities when you work with athletes in development is to build that foundation. You build what's underneath the water. Forget about winning the game on Friday night if you're dealing with 8 or 9 years old. This is not what it's all about. It's about building a foundation to eventually be able to compete at the next level. If you don't do that, then this is what's going to happen. It's going to be fragile, there will be no foundation, and at some point, the iceberg won't be over the water, and then what's going to happen? The athlete will quit or change sport because there's nothing there for them at that moment, okay? So that foundation, guys, it's so important, and you have to keep that in mind all the time. A video that I don't know about, okay? We have a situation in Canada, in our sport of trampoline, which is an Olympic sport. No, they bring it there. And then what we realize is that athletes in development, because it's a judge sport, they do trampoline, and they do their little routine. And the little girl, for the first time, is really, you know, like anxious going to the first competition, and then she practiced for quite some time her routine, and then what's happening? After the first couple of flip, she misses. And then what's happened to her brain at that point? You gotta go back, and then you gotta do it again, that stuff, and then you know that you're screwed because of the point system and everything. So we look at other sports. You know in golf, you know the mulligan? You guys like the mulligan? You can use your mulligan, you know what it is? So you can replay your shot without being penalized. Trampoline is using the mulligan now, for athletes in development. You can use it once during the course of the competition. So little Susie, doing a little flip, and then said, sorry, mulligan, I'm gonna do it again. Is it good for athlete development? It is awesome for athletes in development. And I think in development, later on, when she's capable of dealing with that type of pressure, then we could remove it, okay? So we're stealing ideas from one sport to another in order to benefit the athletes at a different level as well. So we call this the baseball effect. Not only we are guiding, innovating, leading everything that you see there under Baseball Canada, but we are also influencing the game in Canada. And indirectly, we are having positive impact on the society in general. We're not about getting guys to the major leagues. This is not our main thing, guys. As much as you can think that's what we're doing, we want to create a system where whoever has tried baseball before and now being successful in politics, in medicine, in law, and that can credit baseball for the fact that they're successful in their profession, that's what we want. That's 99.9% of the athletes we're dealing with. Totally shift in paradigm. Totally different than what we used to do before. And we know that along the way, we are going to get anyway athletes that will go to US colleges, universities, minor league baseball, and major league baseball itself. And maybe get an MVP award like we had before, a Cy Young award like we had before, and Rookie of the Year award like we had before. So that's going to happen regardless of what we're doing. Okay. So we got to get out of your comfort zone. That's what it is. If you want to do things differently, you got to step out of that little circle so you get to where the magic happens. And this is what we've decided to do at Baseball Canada. And I think we're seeing some of the results, and it's just the beginning of seeing the results. We're going to see even more results, I believe, in a couple of more years. And when we talk about change, I really like that slide. We call it the equation for change. So in everything that we are doing, we are making sure that those five elements at the bottom are covered. We have a vision, we have the skills, we have incentive, we have resource, and we have an action plan. With those five elements, then we can have change. If you're missing one of them, you're going to get somewhere else that you see to the right. Either it's going to be confusion, anxiety, frustration, false start, whatever it is. So in everything that you want to do, if you want to create change in your organization, want to bring things differently, make sure that you cover those five elements at the bottom. It's going to get you there, or at least closer. That's change. 2005, 2013, we're talking 8 years difference. Okay. Those of you who were there last night, another word, please. What event is this?
New Pope got elected.
Pope announcement. 8 years difference. What's the big difference? Technology. Guys, you got to adapt, I'm telling you. Working with athletes nowadays, first thing you have to know, email is out. Now I'm at the point with my athletes, I need to send them a message in WhatsApp to tell them that I send them an email. Seriously. You're there now. If you don't adapt, you're gonna die. And every month, every week, there's another gadget out there. If you don't adapt, you won't have fun, I'm telling you. Okay? And we're gonna talk about that. And at some point, I'm gonna ask you, because I like those things where you can actually create something in those type of presentations. I'm going to ask you to create your social media policy. Do you have one? How many of you have one?
Social media policy.
Policy, yeah. How do you want your athletes to behave on social media? You have to deal with that nowadays, and I'm going to challenge you to build your own quickly. It's not going to be in depth, but we're going to talk about it. So guys, we're talking your athletes right now that are from the age of 8 to about 20. It's called the Generation Z, or Z, however you pronounce it. Okay? It's the generation right after the millennials. Okay? So for me, it's most of my athletes that I'm dealing with right now. It's a totally different beast. Okay? And we're going to look at how they are behaving. Because if you don't know, you can't adapt to them. You cannot adapt your behaviors. So you're going to serve their needs. So obviously you know that they are connected. They are connected to the technology more and more. And knowing that, you have to make sure that you understand how your message and your teaching will be delivered to them. Okay? How are they going to learn? And tonight will be all about learning. Okay? And this is what they are. Okay, I won't go through everything there, but they spend 7.5 hours a day in front of a screen. This is the generation you're dealing with right now. That's a lot. Okay? About eight hours a day in front of a screen. Okay? They send about 100 text messages per day. Their attention span is about 8 seconds. Okay, right here. 2.8 to 8 seconds, that's the attention span of the athletes that you're dealing with today, 2017. Okay? So that tells you what? If you have a conversation with your team, if you're having a conversation with an athlete, and you talk to them for 15, 20, 30 minutes, guys, what are you doing? It's going nowhere. They won't retain anything. So you got, I'm not telling you that you only have an 8-second conversation. Obviously not. But you need to be cognizant to the fact that the more you talk, the less they learn. Okay? And that's going down every year. 2010, the attention span was 12 seconds. 7 years later, we're at 8 seconds. It's going down. So it means that it's probably going to go down a little bit more in the next couple of years. This one's funny too. I'll let you read it. That's what it is, guys. That's what it is nowadays. Okay, so you need to adapt. So we want to talk about learning. That's coming. You see that in China. Okay, I don't think it's not coming in your world soon. That's coming. Okay, because in your some university, this is what we see also. Okay, that's coming, guys. That's and like it or not, we might be against social media, might be against technology, but you won't win that battle. I'm telling you, you won't win it. Okay, so you got to deal with this one for sure. Okay, we called it the generation of affluenza. They have everything. They have access to everything, whether it's technology, whether it's information, anything that they need. And that's why now when I do conferences, we used to talk about all the techniques and everything. Seriously, guys, you can find anything you want online. And any techniques you want to find, you can find it online nowadays. If you go back 15, 20 years ago, you could not find it. That's why I don't talk about technique anymore, because you have access to all kinds of different things. Okay? I want it to be a little bit more different. But that generation has everything that they want. And they want instant gratification. They want to know right away if they did something good or bad. Okay, so that should influence how you approach your athletes in your environment, in your baseball environment. You need to let them know if they're doing something good, what they're doing something bad, and what they should be improving and focusing on moving forward. Okay? You have to be a good communicator. That's very important. When we ask them what they like as a coach, that's the Generation Z, this is what they want to answer you. We like a coach that is caring and encouraging. We like a coach that knows the sport. We like a coach that does not yell and remains calm. And they like a coach that involves the team in decision making. It's not me making it up. It's them telling us what they want, what they look for in a coach that they're going to be ready to play for that coach or play in collaboration with that coach. This is us. This is them telling us what they're looking at. Okay. And that, guys, is so important. If you have one slide to remember, it's probably this one. And that goes to the little rugby player earlier, the challenge zone. And it's called a challenge zone for a reason, not only for the athletes, but for you guys also as coaches, because it's a challenge to meet this, okay? Explain it quickly. So to the left, you have the difficulty of the task. Whether it's a drill, whatever you do, it's how difficult it is. At the bottom, it's easy. At the top, more difficult, okay? At the bottom, you have the participant skill level. Is he good at it, or is he not good at it? To the left, not very good. To the right, pretty good. So if you mix the two together, for example, you have something that is high in difficulty, but you're not very good at it. What's going to happen? Anxiety, frustration, you won't have fun much in dealing with that particular drill. Okay? And on the other side, if you're good at it and the task is very easy, you're going to be bored. Okay, so your challenge for every drill that you're doing, and I'm not here tonight to give you drills, I won't give you any drills. Okay, you guys can figure it out. I'm not giving you drills. Okay, I create my own, and you guys figure that out. Okay, and I'm not about drills. But I'm about finding my drills, adjusting them. So every time I have a drill, I want to be here. I want to create that situation where each of my athletes will be challenged and will have a chance to succeed. That means being flexible, that you need to adapt in order to meet the needs of your athletes. Okay? give you an example, really, really good, easy example. If I hit 10 fungal balls to him and tell him that you need to field 8 correctly, properly, okay? And for whatever reason, him is weaker. And I have the same objective. It doesn't work. So for him, it should be maybe it's 6, maybe for her, it's 10 out of 10, maybe for him, it's 2 out of 10. So can you imagine now the amount of work that you have to do for each drill that you're creating? You have to be flexible enough for your athletes to be in that challenge zone all the time. And for every competition situation that you're creating in baseball in your country, you should have a competition system where two teams are matched together based on competencies. Like, who's having fun in a 25-0 game? Nobody. Okay, in baseball, nobody's having fun. Nobody's getting challenged. But we keep using the same system because it was created 50 years ago. We think it's still good today, but it's not. Okay, so we need to change things. I know last year I challenged you guys to think differently, and I know when I presented that for the first time, I thought that I was a UFO coming from another planet. But think about it. Who decided, you know, baseball, what determines who wins or loses a game? It's the number of times you touch home plate. You go around, you touch home plate, right? So the more you do that, if you do that more than the other teams, you win. In football, it's the number of times the ball enters the net. In hockey, it's the puck entering the net. In basketball, the number of times the basketball enters the hoop. This is what determines the winner and the loser. Who said that was the best method to score a game for kids? Who decided that? So think about it. If tomorrow morning, change the rule. Every time there is a ground ball hit in baseball, let's say for a 10-year-old, 12-year-old, and the ball is fielded properly by the shortstop, and little Johnny throws the ball properly to first base, and little Paul receives the ball properly at first base, I'm telling you now that it counts for 3 points for your team. What are you going to do? What are you going to do? You get 3 points. Fill the ground ball, throw the first base properly, and first baseman catches the ball. What are you going to do in your practice?
Ground balls all day.
You're going to practice those things, right? Because because remember, coaches will always coach the competition system. Always. Whatever you change, coaches will always adapt to the competition system. As a system, are you going to be happy with that? Of course, they are developing skills more than ever. So we're piloting it right now, a totally different scoring system for our kids in development, because we don't believe the way it is right now is purposeful, meaningful for that age group. You've probably seen that before. VUCA is volatility, uncertainty, complexity, ambiguity. You've probably seen it on the web. That changed. Before we had stability, we were looking for stability, certainty, simplicity, and clarity. Now we understand that the world is complex. We understand that athlete development is complex. So you need to be in your discomfort all the time if you want learning. If you stay to the right and stay comfortable, you're not going anywhere. You need to fail. That's what it's all about, okay? So the question for you is, what's your learning style? There's three types of learners, okay? We got the people that are learned by hearing something, auditory. We got the visual people, and we got the kinesthetic people. Those people like learn by doing. Okay, why is it important for you guys to know your own learning style? And I know most of you guys probably don't know your own learning style as a person, how you learn the best, if you remember your years at school and everything. Why is it important to know that? Yeah?
Because you're going to structure your teachings around what's best for you.
Exactly. Very good answer. Thank you. So you're going to do everything. If you're a visual person, you're going to teach like everyone in front of you are visuals. Okay? How many of you guys think are visuals? Okay, let's test it up.
Somebody in this room murdered Lord Smythe, who, at precisely 3:34 this afternoon, was brutally bludgeoned to death with a blunt instrument. I want each of you to tell me your whereabouts at precisely the time that this dastardly deed took place?
I was polishing the brass in the master bedroom.
I was buttering his lordship's scones below stairs, sir.
Fine, I was planting my petunias in the potting shed. Constable, arrest Lydia Smythe. But how did you know? Madam, as any horticulturist will tell you, one does not plant petunias until May is out. Take her away. It's just a matter of observation. The real question is, how observant were you? Clearly, somebody in this room murdered Lord Smythe, who, at precisely 3:34 this afternoon, was brutally bludgeoned to death with a blunt instrument. I want each of you to tell me your whereabouts at precisely the time that this dastardly deed took place.
I was polishing the brass in the master bedroom.
I was buttering his lordship's scones below stairs, sir.
I was lodging my petunias in the rocking chair. Constable, arrest Lady Smythe.
All right. So, why is that we miss all those things? Guys, you can't do two things at the same time. Even women claim it, they can't. They just can't. It's impossible for the human being to do two things at the same time. So you were focusing on the story. It was a simple story, and you missed everything. And sometimes with baseball players also, that are learning, their attention is not placed at the right place, on the right details. Okay, so let's go a little bit more in details on that. So we talked about that question. So how's your style influence how you coach? Are you going to coach to the same learning styles as you are? So your challenge is for you guys that are visuals to make sure that when you teach something, that you're not only serving the needs of the visual people, but you're also covering the auditory people, also covering the kinesthetic people. Okay? And how do we do that? You need to demonstration. You cover the visual, you got to explain, and you got to find images for the brain of the kinesthetic to understand a little bit better. Okay? And you got to mix them all together so you serve the needs of everyone. And we can go deeper in that. Worried about the number of slides I have. I think I'm only at 1/4. So you're gonna deal with all kinds of different types of learners. Okay, so you're gonna have the inexperienced baseball player. You just started, and you gotta have the experienced one. Okay, and you're gonna have the mature one, and you're gonna have the immature one also. Okay, and whatever we mix them all together, obviously, this is where you want to bring your athletes at some point so they're self, 10 minutes, so they're self-directed. So they can teach themselves without having your help all the time. They can rely on their teammates, they can rely on other means than you as a coach, okay? Yes, they're gonna evolve, and you know what? Like, the cool thing about this, and the most difficult thing also at the same time, is that you're gonna get kids in all of those four quadrants at the same time. And they all need different things from you. All need different things from you, okay? So praise is your favorite tool. And I'm gonna explain to you why, and I'm gonna explain a little bit a research that has been made years ago and how it influences everything now that we're doing in learning, okay? So here we go. An easy test, written test, was given to 400 people. Easy test. Okay, 400, okay? After the test, 200 receive a praise based on intelligence, such as, you must be really smart at this. You did very well. You must be a really smart person. That was a kind of feedback we gave to that after group, okay? You guys here are you guys, the intelligent group. The 201 was based on effort. The feedback was, oh, you did well. You must have worked really hard at it. That's you guys here. Effort. Okay? Intelligent, effort. Got it? So far, so good? Perfect. Let's keep going. Then, to the two groups, they were offered two options. We're going to give you a second test. You have the option between having a harder test or an easy test. What are you going to decide? What do you think the answer? What do you think those guys here, the intelligent people, answered?
Harder.
And how about those guys?
Same.
Okay, let's take a look at it. You sure? You say the opposite? Okay. So the intelligent group, that's you guys, pick the easy version at 67%. Yeah, really. And that research study was repeated several times. It's confirmed, right? And the other group, just before, why do you think they picked that one? Because they wanted to look good again. They wanted to feel good about it, so they picked something easy, right? The other group picked the harder version at 92%. Interesting. Why? Because they were embracing the challenge. They wanted that challenge. They wanted to get the effort out of their body again. All right? So what does that tell us? Then the two guys were offered a hard test. They didn't have a choice after that. So the intelligence praise group got frustrated and they gave up early. While the other group, they enjoyed it, they work harder and longer. Following me so far? Let's keep going. Finally, they were asked to do one last test, and it was again an easy test. What do you think happened? And this is where it's the aha. The intelligent group dropped by 20%, same level test at the beginning, and the effort group went up 30%. That's a difference of about 50% of performance. Is that important? Guys, it's only one word, only one sentence, one feedback that you gave the athletes. So the ability group, that's you guys, intelligence, their main focus was on how they look. While the other group, their main focus was on getting better. So what type of athlete do you want? You probably, if you're like me, you want the right field, right? The right guys, this is what you want. But it all started with one phrase that was different from one group to another. So the results are clear. This had a huge impact on the students, because I was students that did this, the little experiment. And remember, this was all from one sentence of feedback. Only one thing that changed everything. Imagine what could happen over the course of a few years, or the course of a couple weeks, a couple months, a couple years. It's just building and building and building. Okay? I have 5 minutes now, or? Okay. So quickly, a little summary of that presentation. So the ability praise group, you guys here, did well on the first test, praise for abilities, focus on how they look, choose the easy test, avoid taking risk. Do we want athletes avoiding taking risk? Hopefully not. Avoid new challenges, and when it got hard, they gave up, became frustrated. When the game of baseball is gonna become hard, those guys will give up. Those guys will continue to fight for you guys as coaches. I'm gonna wait for the couple of photos here. Come on, Ronnie. So we don't praise intelligence or abilities. You praise the process and effort. Key in everything that you're doing. Okay? Because at the end of the day, like, it's not what you want. You don't want your kids to do. You don't want your kids to lose interest and say, well, I'm done, I've got to do something else. How much time do I have? Because if I start this.
About 5 minutes.
Okay, I have time. Worst case, I'm going to finish.
We can ask questions. Do you have questions on it?
I can stop here then?
Yeah.
Okay. Maybe tonight at 10 o'clock, I'm going to continue. I'm not even halfway, guys. I have another session tomorrow, but I'm not even halfway. Okay, any questions so far? Where we're going after, I can just quickly go over the tiger, because that's the type of thing that you want. Those guys here, so those were my intelligent group, okay? Let's say that they are all tigers, but they're that type of tigers in a cage. Is that an easy life, you think? Is that an easy life? It's pretty easy, why?
You get fed every day.
You don't have to chase for food. What else? People throwing popcorn at you at the zoo? That's cool. You don't have to hunt. You have to chase other animals to stay alive. But what happened with the tiger?
Lose instinct.
Lose creativity, and at the end of the day, it's a bit useless. Okay. Well, we have our guys over here. You guys are jungle tigers. Okay.
Yeah.
So what do you have to do? What do you have to do? You're jungle tigers. Nobody's going to come and feed you every morning or every night or every afternoon. What are you going to do? You got to start hunting. You're going to find ways to stay alive by chasing, hunting around you, and keep food coming and bring food to your family also. It's two different environment. Okay? Compare this to athletes now. What type of tigers do you want? Do you want athletes that are going to be comfortable, giving them everything that they need? Or you're going to be, you want to have tigers that's going to go out there, be creative, and survive to what all kinds of different situations you're going to be fighting, you're going to be facing. You want that type, you want that jungle tiger attitude out. That's so important. Alright, sorry. He's got too much.
Andrew's gonna pick it up. We'll get another one.